fearless and free. Just follow me, and you'll see, you and me, it's so good to be footloose and free. I wander around through countryside and town. Come with me, come on, see what's done, what's still to be done. The world is my playground, song. I believe in truth, love, and freedom. I visit all, but stay with none for long. Yeah. Stork Sandal here, and welcome once again. You know, as I crisscross the country daily, I'm amazed at the new things I keep discovering. For instance, do you know that our currency as we know it did not exist in the old days? That there were all sorts of money in circulation? And that some local businessmen issued their own money? It's a fascinating and revealing story. And so too is the work of a dedicated band of young people, keepers of the flame, so to speak, who are helping to preserve our beaches as well as our wildlife. Then, I'm going to take you back to those early school days for a look-see at the kinds of snacks and sweets we used to enjoy. Do they still exist? We'll find out as we go cross-country.
I'm footloose and free. Just follow me.
We always take for granted the fact that we have money to buy things we want or need. But did you know that there was a time in this country when money as we know it did not exist? People used things like sugar and tobacco to trade for goods. And when we did have some currency in these islands, it was not even our own. In fact, Trinidad and Tobago did not really have its own currency until after we became independent. Could you believe that? When the British came to Trinidad, in 1797, they found all manner of coins and tokens substituting as money. There were Spanish coins, including the doubloon and the silver dollar, pieces of eight from Mexico, Portuguese gold coins called Johannes or half Joes, as well as French, due to the large number of those settlers who had escaped the revolution in Haiti. In Tobago, there was a similar combination of Spanish, Portuguese and French coins. In addition, King Sugar was the currency in all the colonies throughout the 18th century and was predominant in many of them well into the 19th. All transactions between merchants in London and planters in Trinidad were based on the value of sugar. Early attempts to rationalize the system of exchange were unsuccessful, and in March of 1825, an order in council was passed, thereby introducing the shilling as the standard coin of the empire. But even this attempt at rationalization was a failure. From what I've gathered, it was the abolition of slavery which forced the monetization of the Trinidad economy. Emancipation meant that the plantation was no longer the total institution. Slaves became employees, self-employed craftsmen and artisans. They worked for wages and bought their own food and clothing. In Trinidad, where land was plentiful, free men set up villages and the peasants small holdings in the island's interior. Planters therefore required cash to pay wages, while peasants expected cash payments on the sale of their goods. Emancipation also forced the creation of the Colonial Bank, the forerunner to Barclays, now Republic Bank. The Colonial Bank opened for business in Trinidad in May of 1857 at the corner of St. Vincent Street and King Street, now Independence Square. A chief intention of the lawmakers in setting up the Colonial Bank was that the bank could supply the colonists with enough coinage to sustain a free market and a free labor economy. The bank also produced its own currency notes. Until 1904, the currency in the colony of Trinidad and Tobago comprised a diverse range of coins, as well as the notes of the Colonial Bank. There were also other kinds of money floating around in the system. Merchants and shopkeepers had developed a currency system of their own. Some, like Francois Duclos, stamped their initials on available coins in a bid to increase their value. But Duclos was not the only merchant we know of who created his own currency. John Lelum, who originally came from Guangdong, China, and migrated to this country in 1885, developed his own coins or tokens for use in his establishments. His grandson, James Lelum, managing director of Trinidad Steam Laundry Limited, tells the story of how Lelum coins came about.
In order to do business, it was necessary for him to give credit to the plantation owners. And in the process of granting credit, there were quite a lot of bookkeeping problems that cropped up. The way of issuing credit was by having the manager of one of his stores negotiate a credit limit for a plantation owner. And that plantation owner would in turn issue chits to his workers, a chit valuing so much, maybe $5, $6, $7, $8, $10 or whatever. In those days, I guess that kind of money was a lot of money. And the employee of the plantation owner would go to one of my grandfather's shops to purchase his requirements. And that would involve the problem of bookkeeping, because most of the purchases were maybe 1 cent, 2 cents, 3 cents, 4 cents, or whatever. And it would require opening an account for the employee of the plantation owner. So that when the owner, the employee came to purchase and he had a chit, he would surrender the chit and, hold on to the chit, but whatever amount of purchase that he made at that point of time had to be registered in the account, and there was a balance. But that kind of bookkeeping required so much time and effort that my grandfather realized that he had to introduce something that would bring efficiency in the system. So he decided to issue his own token coins with the permission of the government of the time. And he had those coins minted in Birmingham. And they were in the denomination of 1 cent to 24 cents. So when an employee of a plantation owner who was granted a line of credit came to make his purchase, he would surrender that chit for the whatever amount, and he was given the equivalent amount of Lelum token coins, which the employee could use as money. So there's no problem of bookkeeping. At the end of the crop, when the plantation owner harvested his crop and sold his crop, and he had some money coming in, the manager of my grandfather's shop would go to the plantation owner and have his redeem the chits that were issued, you see, for money. And that's how the system worked.
By 1925, some progress had been made in rectifying the chaotic currency situation which plagued the colonies. However, although Trinidad and Tobago never really adopted the pound, shilling, and pence units. All currency used was definitely linked to sterling, and its value in relation to foreign currencies moved with London. As early as 1923, attempts were being made to create a unified currency system throughout the Eastern Caribbean. The region was to be supplied with currency by three different boards of commission of currency. In 1948, the British Caribbean Currency Board, or BCCB, was established to issue notes and coins in the Eastern Caribbean area. By 1950, each territory had enacted legislation giving the BCCB the sole right, power, and authority to provide, issue currency notes in the colonies. Eventually, the colonies sought the right to determine their own affairs without guidance, direction, or orders from the imperial seat. Independence became reality. And with independence in 1962, Trinidad and Tobago became responsible for its own affairs.
The first responsibility that devolves upon you is the protection and promotion of your democracy.
Particularly, its monetary affairs. The central bank was established. It was originally housed in the old Treasury building in St. Vincent Street before taking up residence in the ultra-modern Twin Tower skyscrapers in 1987. Under the provisions of the Central Bank Act, the first notes of an independent Trinidad and Tobago currency were issued on December 14, 1964. And by July 1967, the British Caribbean Currency Board monies had been replaced by that of the Central Bank of Trinidad and Tobago. However, it was not long before the desire to be completely free of the imperial crown arose once more. And even though independent, with our own democratically elected prime minister and government running the affairs of the nation, Queen of England remained the head of state. And her face graced the currency of our country. In 1977, Trinidad and Tobago became a republic. And in recognition of this change in our political status, the TT dollar was modified with the introduction of the coat of arms to replace the portrait of the Queen on the front of the note. In December 1985, new designs of this country's currency were issued in an effort to thwart would-be counterfeiters. The late 70s and early 1980s were plagued by a series of counterfeit currency scandals. The situation grew so terrible that the $50 note was discontinued and disappeared completely by 1982. These new currency notes, which are those used every day by you and me, have not only been designed in such a way as to be almost counterfeit proof, they proudly bear the hallmarks of our independence and display aspects of our economic life and treasures from nature, our national birds. Our currency, a true expression of our independence. Okay. So now you know how we got our own currency. So the next time you take out a dollar bill, take time out to think about what it really means to have your own currency and to realize that a country having its own money proudly stamped with the symbols of its culture and national life is truly an independent one.
I'm footloose and free.